Welcome everybody. What we intend to do in this session is to talk about harmony in the self. So till now we have been talking about harmony in human being, right? And while talking about harmony in human being, we found that human being is coexistence of self and body, right? And then we looked into the different aspects of the self and the body. Now what we intend to do is to look deeper into the self, right, and investigate more into that. So let's see what we have been talking about till now, you know, before we go about expanding on the harmony in the self. So we have said that the basic purpose of this workshop is to initiate this process of self exploration, the process of self investigation in each one of us. So the content of self exploration, we said, is to find out what is human desire and how this desire can be fulfilled. So what is the program of action? So we are basically investigating into these two things: number one, the desire of human being, and number two, the program of action to ensure the fulfillment of this desire. So we found out that the basic human desire is basically for happiness, prosperity and its continuity. And then as a part of the program, we saw that to ensure continuity of happiness, what we need to do is to understand the harmony and to live in harmony at all levels of our being. That is, we have to understand the harmony in human being, harmony in family, in society, in nature and existence. And if we can understand the harmony at all of these levels and live in harmony, this will ensure continuity of happiness for us, which is the basic human desire. So this is one part that we have said. The second part, we said that the process of self-exploration has two parts. The part one is verifying the proposal which is put forward here on the basis of our own natural acceptance, and part two is validating it on the basis of our living according to it. And as we said, this living has two parts. One is the behavior with human being, the other is rest, work with rest of nature. So if this behavior with human being leads to mutual happiness, it is a right proposal, otherwise it is not a right proposal. And similarly, if work with rest of nature leads to mutual prosperity, it is a right proposal, otherwise it is not a right proposal. So through these two parts of self-verification, we can find out what is right for us, what is not right for us. And as we said, that out of this self-verification, what we achieve is the right understanding, which is basically the first priority for every human being. So then we went about exploring these four levels of human existence one by one. So we started with harmony in human being. When we looked into harmony in human being, we found that human being is coexistence of self and body. The need of the self is different from the need of the body. The need of the self is happiness, while the need of the body is physical facility. And these two needs are of different types. And because they are two different types, they are fulfilled by two different ways, right? In two different ways. The need for happiness is fulfilled by right understanding and right feeling, but the need for physical facility is fulfilled by some physiochemical things. Similarly, we can see that the activity of the self, like desire, thought and expectation, is different from the activity of the, you know, body. And you can see that any activity of the self is continuous in time, like desire, thought, but any work that we take from the body, like eating, walking, is temporary in nature. After some time the body gets tired, therefore we have to give rest to it. And finally, we saw that if you look at the response of the body and the response of the self, they are different. The response of the body is based on recognizing and fulfilling, which is definite, but the response of the self is based on knowing, assuming, recognizing and fulfilling. And as long as we are going by assuming, recognizing and fulfilling, right, it's the conduct will depend upon the assumption, the assuming, and if the assumptions keep changing, our conduct will keep changing, right. And that basically is the source of problem that we see all around. So, as long as we are going by assuming, recognizing and fulfilling, and if assumptions are not definite, that is if it is not based on knowing, then the assumptions keep changing, therefore, recognition and fulfillment keeps changing, therefore, the conduct remains indefinite. But if we are able to ensure this knowing, the right understanding, the knowledge, then the knowledge is definite, right, the right understanding is definite, therefore, the assuming on the basis of knowing is also definite, therefore, recognition and fulfillment is definite, therefore, the conduct becomes definite. So, now you can see that the conduct of human being basically depends upon the response of the self, which is based on assuming, recognizing and fulfilling, or knowing, assuming, recognizing and fulfilling, right. So, this is what we had investigated, and with this investigation we could found that the self is different from the body, and that human being is coexistence of self and the body. We also found that the self, if you look at now self and body, and if you look at the, you know, priority or try to find out which one is playing the central role, the more important role, then we found that basically it is the self which is central to human existence, right. The body is used only as an instrument. So, the self is central to human existence. The body is used as an instrument. So, to clarify this, we made a few observations. First, we found that the only transaction which is taking place between the self and body is in the form of information, right. So, the self is giving some instruction to the body, and self is reading some sensation from the body. This is the total transaction taking place between the self and the body. So, this was one important observation. So, there is no material transaction, right? Only transaction in the form of information, and this transaction is also done by the decision of the self both way. When this self decides to send some instruction to the body, it sends some instruction to the body. When it wants to read some sensation from the body, it reads some sensation from the body. Otherwise, there are a whole lot of sensations taking place in the body anyway. You choose which sensation you would access. So, this was one important observation. The second important observation was that the self has this will to live with continuous happiness, right. So, basically the will to live is with the self, live with continuous happiness. In the process, right, we find that the physical facility is required for the body. So, physical facility is required for nurturing, protection and right utilization of the body. So, what is needed for the body is physical facility, which is required for ensuring the nurturing, protection and right utilization of the body. But the basic will is to live with continuous happiness, which is the need of the self. Then we also found that in order to fulfill the need of the self, our program of action is to understand the harmony and live in harmony at all levels. When it comes to physical facility, which is related to the need of the body, right, the production, protection and right utilization of the physical facility is only a part of this program of ensuring harmony at all levels of our being. And we said it is less than 1/4, because if you look at ensuring harmony with the body, it is a part of this ensuring harmony in human being, which is 1/4 of the, you know, for ensuring harmony at 4 levels. So, in that sense, this our engagement for ensuring the production, the protection and the right utilization of physical facility is less than 1/4 of total program of ensuring continuity of happiness. then we made this observation that if you look at human being, right, we find that it is the self, the I, which is the seer, the doer and the enjoyer, the experiencer. And in the process, the body is used as an instrument. So, I see through eyes, I see through touch, through taste, right. So, it is the self which is seeing, you know, things outside, and it is using the sensation as a means, as an instrument, as and when required. So, it is the self who is the seer, the observer, right. It is using the senses as and when required. Many times we do not even use the senses. So, when we are trying to conclude something, reason out something, right, we are not using the body, we are not using the sensation, right, we are reasoning it out within our own self and coming to a conclusion. So, I am the seer, the self is the seer, the self is taking decision of what to do and what not to do, therefore, the self is the doer. And ultimately, self is the enjoyer of happiness or unhappiness. So, the self is the seer, the doer and the enjoyer. The body is used only as an instrument in the process, and that too as and when required, not always, right. So, with all these observations, we could make this conclusion that self is central to human existence. The body is used only as an instrument, right, of the self, as and when required, not necessary always. In fact, you will see that most of the time you are engrossed in yourself, you are not even accessing sensation from the body, or you are not giving any instruction to the body, right. When you are thinking something deep, you know, you are so much absorbed within your own self that you are not interacting with the body. So, at that point of time, the body is not even used as an instrument, as an equipment. So, this is the observation that we have made till last session. Now, what we want to do is to start looking deeper into the self, right. Try to investigate, you know, into the self in a more defined manner, more subtle manner. So, let us look at that. So, if you look at the self, we said the activity of the self could be identified as desire, thought and expectation, right. So, by now you must have been able to see that we all desire, right, you have thought, you have expectations, right, and all this is going on in you continuously. If you are not able to see that it is continuous, you have to go on finding out, right, go on, you know, exploring, checking whether is there any time when there is no desire or there is no thought, there is no expectation. So, if you look at the self, this activity of desire, thought, expectation is there in each one of us. Now, if you look at it, you know, in detail, you find that when you say desire, it means an activity of imaging. You are making an image, you know, in the self, right. So, when you say desire, there is an image that is being created in you. For example, you have a desire for a big house, right. So, you want to become an owner of a big house, right. So, when you say desire for a big house, you have an image of the house, right. So, when you say desire, it means imaging. Then, when you say thought, it means an activity of analyzing. So, when you have a desire for a big house, owner of becoming a owner of a big house, then you are trying to now work out the details of the house, right. So, imaging is you have an image of the house. Then analyzing means you are trying to work out the details of that house, right. For example, you will have a dining room, a bedroom, a kitchen, you know, a veranda, you know, bathroom, so on and so forth. This is called analyzing, you know, you are trying to separate, you know, these different parts of the image or trying to work out the details of the image. This is called thought. So, when you say thought, it means activity of analyzing. When you say desire, it means an activity of imaging, right. And when you say expectation, it means activity of selecting and testing. So, for example, when you are desiring for a house, a big house, you have an image of it, then you are trying to work out the details, that is analyzing, then you are trying to fill the colors, that is selecting, right. So, here is a house, okay, the drawing room, okay, and you want to decide whether to put the white color or the cream color or blue color, right, on the wall. This selection of color is based on the tasting. So, if you happen to visit somewhere and you saw this cream color and you happen to like the cream color, so you have selected for cream color, right. So, when you say expectation, it means the activity of selecting. So, these three activities, the imaging, the analyzing, the selecting on the basis of testing, right. So, when you say desire, it means imaging, the activity of imaging. When you say thought, it is an activity of analyzing, and when you say expectation, it is an activity of selecting, right, which is of course based on testing. So, basically you can see that these activities are going on in you all the time, and if you put them together, it is called imagination. When you put them together, it is called imagination. So, one imagination or the other is going on in us, in you all the time. This you can look into yourself and find out whether this imagination is going on in you all the time, or you can stop this imagination at any point of time. So, this is important to look into yourself and find out whether this activity of imaging, analyzing, selecting, is it going on you all the time, or is it not going on in you at any point of time. So, if you look at yourself, you will find that some imagination or the other is going on. You will remember there was a serial called Mungeri Lal Ke Haseen Sapne, right. One of the serial, TV serial, it is talking about the beautiful dreams, okay, of a person called Mungeri Lal, right. So, what it depicts in each of the serial is that in the first 1 minute, he is a peon sitting outside the office, right, on a stool. And then he takes off, right. So, he has some imagination which goes on for 28 minutes. Then last 1 minute he realizes that he is sitting outside the office on a stool. Now, this 28 minutes he thinks all kind of things, right, and very interesting serial. But now, if you start looking at yourself, you will find that it is not only the Mungeri Lal who is having these imaginations, right. We all are having imaginations, right, one after the other. And most of the time we are not even able to find out where it is coming from. So, when you are sitting in the class for 1 hour, now you can find out how many imaginations are taking place in you in 1 hour, even in 5 minutes, right. So, many imaginations taking place one after the other, and you may not even be aware of them, right. That is why when we are conducting the class, we keep repeating things so many times, because we know that what is happening to yourself is that this self is jumping from one imagination to another imagination, right. So, by the time I speak something, I state something here, right, you pick up one of the words and then you take off, right? You start imagining of something, right? From there you start imagining of something else and so on. So for 10 minutes you are off, right? Off the class, right? So you are in your own imagination and you don't know what is going on in the class. So 10 minutes after, 15 minutes after, you come back and you try to trace what is, you know, being talked about. So by keeping at your competence, we keep repeating this, you know, 10 times, 20 times, right? Because even if you come back after 15 minutes, you should be able to, you know, find out what is being talked about. So these imaginations are going on one after the other. Even if you observe yourself for 5 minutes, you will find some 10, 20, 30 of imaginations have already gone through, right? So that is important. That imagination which is going on in the self is important. And we are saying that human being, if you look at human being, the self is central to human existence. And if you look at the self, this imagination is a central thing, right? Because it is this imagination which connects to your behavior and work. So any behavior you are doing outside with other human being, the decision is taken at the level of this imagination. Any work that you are doing with rest of nature, the decision is taken at the level of this imagination. So this is the place where decisions are taken, right? So here the decisions are taken. Here the decisions are executed, right? Executed if found necessary, not always. Can you see that? Yeah. This is not a very essential thing to do, execution of the decision. I have been taking this example again and again, that when you are thinking of taking revenge from someone, right? For 2 hours you think of it, after 2 hours you drop the idea, right? Is there any execution? No, no execution at the level of the body, right? At the level of behavior and work. But so much has taken place at the level of imagination. And this becomes the source of your happiness or unhappiness. Because if this imagination is in, you know, contradiction with your natural acceptance, it will lead to unhappiness, right? So for 2 hours you were thinking of opposition which is not naturally acceptable to you, therefore for 2 hours you are in a state of unhappiness. So this imagination is very important, you know, is central to the self, because it connects the self to its happiness and unhappiness, and it also connects the self to the world outside, to the body and the world outside, right? So it is very important to understand this, you know, very important to see what is going on there, and then later on we will see it is very important to make sure that whatever is going on in this imagination is in line with my natural acceptance, because that will ensure happiness. If it is otherwise, that is, if it is in contradiction with natural acceptance, then it will lead to unhappiness, right? So this is a very, very important part of the self, and we would say it is very central thing, you know, for the self. So this is what, you know, we have to start looking into. So if you look at into little bit of details of this, we said, when we are saying imaging or desiring, this is related to what to be and what to do. When we are saying analyzing, this is working out the details of how to be and how to do, right? And when we are saying selecting, this is selection outside, right? So the first one, the desire, has to do with myself, right? With my state of being. right, what I want to become, right, what I want to do. The second one is, if I want to do this or if I want to become like this, how do I go about it? And the third has to do with, what do I do outside, right, in order to become what I want to become or in order to do what I want to do. So, this imagination is something which is going on in each one of us, and the behavior and work that we see, okay, is a natural outcome of this imagination. So, can we see this? Can we see that this imagination is going on in each one of us, right, every moment continuously? And we will ask later on that if it is going on all the time, are you really aware of it? Okay. So, let us look at this and see if there are any question, immediate question to this. So, what do you find? These imaginations are going on, not going on?
Going on,
right. So, at least this you can see, you know. But let, as you go on, we will find out whether it is going on continuously or there is a point of time when there is no imagination taking place. What do you feel, prima facie? Is going on all the time or you are able to stop it? Till you observe, you will find, yes, it is going on, right. I may be aware of it, I may not be aware of it. But whether it is there all the time or not is that you have to go on verifying, right. Somebody was asking yesterday that when I am in sleep, does it go on, right. So, that you have to find out when you are sleeping, right. So, good. So, this is what we are saying, that this is imagination in the self which is going on all the time, which constitutes of this activity of imaging, activity of analyzing, activity of selecting and testing, right. Now, if you start looking at this imagination, what you would observe that very large number of time, okay, this imagination is really very random, right. Which means you are very confused, right. So, if you look at this, you know, imagination, this is how it looks like, right. This is the state of your imagination. How do you find it? Is it confused, random, or is it organized?
Unorganized.
Unorganized, right. Yeah. So, when you start looking at it, you will find that many of these imaginations, right, that you have, that are going on, may be very contrary to each other, right. So, you start with some point here, then you jump to this point. Then from there you jump to this point, from there you jump to this point, right. And if you draw it after 5 minutes, this is how it would look like. And you are not able to even find out the correlation, how, why I did jump, you know, from here to here to here to here and so on. Isn't it? So, when you do this observation, you will find that many of these imaginations may be contrary to each other and contrary to the natural acceptance. So, if they are contrary to each other, you will be in a state of unhappiness. If they are contrary to your natural acceptance, then also you are in a state of unhappiness, right. But this is what keeps on going, and you are not even aware where they are coming from. That is another question you can ask yourself, that are you having this imagination by your decision, or they just keep coming without you knowing where they are coming from?
May I ask one question? Is there any analysis that suppose 10 people are there and their imagination is somewhat similar, or it is always, it may be differ from man to man? No?
Yeah, no, it differs from man to man, and it also differs in the same man. If you ask him to absorb for 10 minutes and then another 10 minutes, it will be quite different.
Quite different.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That is the status. So they may be contrary to each other, and they may be contrary to the natural acceptance. Therefore, they will lead to a state of unhappiness, right? And you can see that these contradictions in desires, in thoughts, in expectation, this contradiction between desire and thought, this contradiction between desire, thought and expectation, and the natural acceptance, all these contradictions result into unhappiness. So many permutations and combinations are there, right? So if there is contradiction between one desire and the other desire, you are in a state of unhappiness. If there is a contradiction between the desire and the thought, you are in a state of unhappiness. If there is a contradiction between the desire, thought and expectation, then you are in a state of unhappiness. And if all these are in contradiction with the natural acceptance, you are anyway in a state of unhappiness. So all this cause of unhappiness that you have within has to do with this contradiction at the level of desire, at the level of thought, at the level of expectation, and all this put together at the level of natural acceptance. So if you observe carefully, we realize that we have accumulated a lot of desires which are resulting in numerous thoughts and expectations. So what has happened is that very unknowingly, right, very unconsciously, we have accumulated lot of these desires, lot of these thoughts, lot of these expectations, and we are not aware of it. So we have accumulated so much, right? All this put together is what we are calling a sanskar, you know. So lot of accumulation has taken place in this self, and then this self is working with all these, you know, accumulation, right? So many of these imaginations are springing out of that accumulation, or out of some situation outside and the accumulation, and so on, and you are not even aware what is really happening. So if you look at this state of imagination, right, and try to observe, you will find that the harmony in the self is realized when there are no contradictions in the imagination, right. No contradiction within the imagination, no contradiction of the imagination with the natural acceptance. Then only the self is in harmony, then only you are in a state of happiness within. Right. So this we will try to explore as we go on, that the harmony in the self can be ensured only when our imagination is in line with our natural acceptance and there are no contradictions within the imagination. Right. So that is about the random and the disorganized imagination. If we look at this organized, you know, and the harmonized, you know, imagination, then it will look like this. The consistent and the organized imagination would look like this. Like you have a desire, basic desire, like desire for continuity of happiness. Right, and you can see that this desire for continuity of happiness can be ensured, you know, or fulfilled by ensuring harmony in the self, harmony in, you know, family, in society, in nature and existence. So there are sub desires like D1, you know. So this is the basic desire for continuity of happiness. Then this is ensured by way of ensuring harmony at the level of self, human being, at the level of family, society, nature and existence. So these are the sub desires. Then you have some, you know, details of how to ensure the fulfillment of this, you know, harmony in the self. So we are trying to work out the details of that, right? So you have thought T1, T12, T13, T14, which are the details of this D1, right? So these are the thoughts that you have. And for every thought, let's say T11, you have some expectation, some way of going about outside. So E11, E112, E13, E114, and so on. So if you have this kind of clarity, that is, you know your desire, you know the sub desires, right? You know what you have to do, right? How to go about fulfilling this desire D11. So some thought is there. Then for that thought, what you have to do outside, the details you have, that is expectation, right? So this is how a consistent and organized imagination would look like. So you can find out whether your imagination is going like this or it is going like this. Like this. What do you think? Like this, right? Yes, this is the image of your imagination. Yeah, in fact, if you really do the homework for 1 hour, it will be worse. Okay. You will not be able to see the, you know, space in between. It will be all jumbling up. So this is about the imagination itself. And as I said, this imagination is going to play a very important role, because it is through this imagination that we are taking decision of what to do outside, you know, how to behave, how to work, right? And it is this imagination which will, you know, decide whether you will be in a state of happiness or unhappiness. Because if this imagination is in line with your natural acceptance, you will be in a state of harmony within, therefore in a state of happiness within. If this imagination is in contradiction with your natural acceptance, then you will be in contradiction within, therefore you will be in a state of disharmony within, right? Therefore you will be in a state of unhappiness within, right? So this is what we saw, that if you look at the self now, first thing that we can look at is the imagination, right? Imagination which takes the decision for what to do, what not to do outside, right? Which takes the decision for the behavior with human being outside, takes the decision for work with rest of nature outside, right? So we have done this thing, that is, we have looked into the self, we have found out this activity of imagination, which is of course combination of these three activities of imaging, analyzing, selecting and testing. Then we have also seen that this imagination is the basis of what we do outside in terms of behavior and work. Then we have also tried to see some, you know, get some idea about the state of this imagination, whether it is organized or disorganized, whether it is confused or it is, you know, consistent. Now the next question that we want to ask, you know, and investigate is that if you look at this imagination, look at this desire, thought and expectation, where are they coming from? Who is deciding on them? What is the source of motivation? Are you deciding them yourself, or your parents are deciding, your friends are deciding, your teacher is deciding, right? The social environment is deciding.
Sir.
Yeah.
I'm deciding myself.
Yeah. What about other people?
It's look like I am deciding, but when we question deeper ki how that desire came, then we find out ki by seeing someone other, by looking at an advertisement sometime, or that's why I decided much amount of maybe.
Yeah. For example, you want to come first in the class. This is your desire, right? Where did it come from? Did you decide it yourself, right? Or it came from your parents? It came from your teachers? It came from your friends, right? Or it came from the social environment? What is it?
It is a combination of all this. Helicopter wearing around us, maybe social, maybe parental, maybe family. So it is the combination of all thoughts.
Yeah. And we don't ask this question.
Huh?
We don't ask this question as to where it is coming from. Yeah. So if you really start looking into it, you will find that there are three possible sources. Right? The most important and most dominant source is the preconditioning, right? The most dominant one is the preconditioning. The preconditioning which is prevailing around. For example, if a parent says 10 times you have to come first in the class, right? Now you have a desire to come first in the class. If your friend says you have to come first in the class, if the teacher says you have to come first in the class, right, then you have a desire to come first in the class. So whatever preconditionings are there around in society, in the family, right, in the school. So whatever is there, okay, this preconditioning existing in the society, that is what you pick up. So if I ask you whether you want to come first in the class or you want to understand what is being taught, what is your natural acceptance? What is your natural acceptance?
To understand.
To understand. Right? So left to yourself, you will like to understand what is being taught in the class rather than keeping yourself busy to come first. Can you see that? Yeah. Good. So you want to come first in the class because your parents wanted it, right? Or your friends wanted it, or your teacher wanted it, or the society wanted it, right? So you can see that a large number of desires, okay, that you have are coming through preconditioning. Very large percentage of your desires are coming through preconditioning, right? In fact, the way you dress, the way you talk, right? Most of these are coming from your preconditioning. I was describing that example yesterday, that in Bombay, when we are going for a workshop, okay, through a steamer, I found that everybody, there was wearing a torn cloth. So I asked my host, I said, what has happened? Bombay has gone so fatehal. So she was shocked. He said, what happened? I said, everybody is wearing a torn cloth. So everybody's trouser was torn at the bottom. She said, oh, you don't know, this is a fashion. This was 2003, right? That time this was the fashion. Okay. I said, if they have to wear a torn cloth, why do they need to get it stitched? But you know, there is a fashion, and this fashion means some preconditioning has been created around. Okay. So now you are paying for stitching the trouser, then you are paying for turning the, you know, tearing the trouser. Just imagine. And then somebody was mentioning that you have those jeans, you know, which is torn and then stitched, right? So you have to pay thrice, first to stitch, then to tear, then to be, you know, stitch again, right? Yeah. Those heels, high heels and low heels, right? Shoes. Every 6 months the fashion will change, so the preconditioning is changing, so you have to keep changing your shoes. So these preconditionings, right, keeps on deciding on your desire, on your thought, on your expectation. Can you see that? Right. So this is one major source. The other major source of your desire, of your imagination, is this sensation. Right? This is the other major source. For example, if you are going by the road, okay, and a very shining red car, you know, passes by, right? Now you are dragged by that car, you want that car because you happen to like the color, or you happen to like the shape, you happen to like the speed or something like that, right? So this sensation has impacted on you. So now you have a desire for that car. Does it happen? Yeah, that is how it has been happening, right? That is how you have been accumulating those desires, those thoughts, those expectations. Right, and you are not even aware of it. You know, I keep taking this example that, you know, you go to a restaurant and this waiter comes and asks, "What should I bring?" Right, and you say Coca-Cola. Right, now does it come, you know, to you by your own decision, or is it because you have seen some advertisement sometime? Right, 2 times, 3 times, jindagi ho to aisi. They will say jindagi ho to aisi, and then they will show Coca-Cola drinking, you know, and you think that, you know, it will be something very great. I mean, they don't tell you kaisi, but you know, but somehow you create your own impression, and next time the waiter comes and asks, "What should I bring?" you say Coca-Cola. That is how your imaginations are being motivated, you know, from outside, by preconditioning or by sensation. Yeah. And then you think that it is your desire, right? You have decided it, you know, you decided to drink Coca-Cola or Fanta or something, right? So these are the two major sources. One is the preconditioning, the other is the sensation, right? Can you see that? Or is there any other source? These are the two sources. Can you see that? These are the two possible sources. Then can you see that there is, can be any other source? Or there is any other source for you? Yes, let's see. No source? Think. Very difficult to rub them off, huh?
My inner voice.
Inner voice. Yeah. So that is third possible source, right? The inner voice, which you hardly access, right? Oh. You have to take training for even rubbing off things. So many of preconditionings becoming part of your desire, to rub them off is very difficult. You can rub off what is written here, but rubbing them off your imagination is very difficult. Yeah. So the second source was sensation, and the third possible source is your inner voice, right? Your natural acceptance. So we are saying self-verification on the basis of your natural acceptance can be the third possible source, and that is what we have been talking about, right, from the first day. But if you look at the possibility of it before this, right, discussion we started, it seems to be very minimal. But what we are saying is that this can be the real source for deciding your desire, thought and expectation, right? This self-verification on the basis of your natural acceptance can be a real source for deciding your desire, your thought, your expectation, that is for guiding your imagination. So now we will see that if, as far as this imagination is concerned, as far as this desire, thought and expectation is concerned, there are three possible sources. One is the preconditioning prevailing in the society, in the parents, in the teachers, in the friends, you know, in the social environment. Then second one is the sensation, right, that you come across. And the third possible source is the self-verification on the basis of your natural acceptance. Can you see this? Yes. Now tell me, let us say out of 100 of your desires that you have accumulated, what will be the percentage of your preconditioning, desires coming from preconditioning? What percentage out of 100? Yeah, 70 to 80%. Then how many percent, what percent from sensation? Good. And
almost 10 to 15.
10 to 15. Then what percent from natural acceptance? Very less, right? Both come. Yeah. So this you can see. And with this observation, right, now we can also see that as long as my desires are coming from preconditioning through this route, I am not sure whether this is in harmony with my natural acceptance or not in harmony with my natural acceptance. Therefore, I am not sure whether with this desire I will be in harmony within or I will be in harmony in contradiction within. So I am not sure whether I will be in harmony within or in contradiction within. Therefore, I am not sure whether I will be in a state of happiness within or unhappiness within, right? Similarly, when the desire is based on the sensation, I am not very sure whether this is in line with my natural acceptance or not in line with my natural acceptance. So there again, I am not very clear whether it will lead to a state of happiness or unhappiness, right? Only when my desire is coming through natural acceptance that I can be sure that I am in harmony within, because my imagination is in line with my natural acceptance. So only then I am in a state of harmony within, and therefore I am in a state of happiness within. So if I can look at this and I can realize this, then I see that only when my desire is coming through natural acceptance, I will be in harmony within, and therefore I will be in a state of happiness within. Otherwise I am not sure, right. So the only way to ensure harmony at the level of self or harmony in the self is to ensure that all my desire, thought and expectation, all my imagination are in line with my natural acceptance. Right. So let me ask this question to you, that if your desires are decided by preconditioning, right, shall I call it Swatantrata, right, the decision is taken by yourself or it is decided by somebody else? So this is Pratantrata, right, which is not the right way to go about. Similarly, if it is based on sensation, it is Pratantrata. Only when it is based on my own natural acceptance, on my, you know, on the basis of my self-verification based on natural acceptance, then it is a state of Swatantrata. I am deciding thing on my own. Otherwise, I am dictated by the other or by the conditions outside. So if I have to conclude this, okay, this is what is being said, that only when the desires are coming from natural acceptance, right, the purpose, what to do, you know, what to be as a human being, leads to harmony within, right. There is a continuity in desire, is, you know, continuity is desirable and possible, right. And you can see that the natural acceptance is for relationship, for harmony and for coexistence, and not for, you know, opposition or exploitation or conflict. So only when my desired thoughts and expectations are coming through natural acceptance, I will be in a state of harmony within. This will lead to harmony within. Therefore, it will lead to a state of happiness within. So that is the meaning of harmony in the self, right. So harmony in the self is ensured only when my desire, thought and expectation, right, this is coming from this and not otherwise. So can you see that? The other two conditions, either coming from preconditioning or coming from sensation, right, is questionable or is not right, not the right way of going about it for ensuring the harmony in the self. So only this assurance that all my desire, thought and expectations are in line with my natural acceptance will lead to harmony within, therefore will lead to state of happiness within. On the other hand, if it is coming through this and this, it might lead to contradiction, therefore the state of unhappiness within. Yes, can you see that, or there is any question?
Okay.
So what we were saying was that only when our imagination is in line with our natural acceptance, we can be sure that we are in harmony within, and only then we can be sure that we are in a state of happiness within. So essentially what we are saying is that depending upon whether your imagination is guided by preconditioning or by sensation or by natural acceptance, you will be in a state of harmony or disharmony, right? And therefore you will be in a state of happiness or dishappiness, unhappiness. So if you look at this, what we are saying is that if the imagination is guided by preconditioning, then it means assuming without knowing, right? So it depends on something or someone outside. It keeps changing, not sure if it leads to harmony or if it leads to contradiction. So that is the state when you are guided by preconditioning. So you cannot be sure that it will lead to a state of harmony all the time. It may or may not lead to harmony. Therefore, it may or may not lead to happiness. Similarly, when it is guided by sensation, then happiness from favorable sensation of sound, touch, form, taste and smell is there, right? For example, happiness from indulgence of food, sleep and so on, right? If you look at this, this has a problem that the same physical facility may be a source of happiness to begin with, but after some time it will become intolerable. That is something that we have discussed quite in detail, which is sensation will lead to harm, at least it might or it might not. So what we are saying that ultimately only when your imagination is coming from natural acceptance, right, or is aligned with your natural acceptance, that you can be sure that your imagination is in harmony, right, your imagination is in harmony with your natural acceptance, therefore you are in harmony within, therefore within. The purpose is clear to you, what to be, what to do is clear to you on the basis of your desire, thought and expectations are anyway in line with your natural acceptance because it is based on natural acceptance, right? And this harmony will lead to happiness, and of course there will be continuity of such desire, right? Therefore, there is a possibility of continuity of happiness, right? Now, if you look into this, you know, natural acceptance and try to find out the exact details, then we can see that we have natural acceptance, number one, for relationship, right? Number two, for harmony, number three, for coexistence. So two things we are saying. Number one, this natural acceptance, okay, if our imagination is aligned with our natural acceptance, we will be in harmony within, therefore we will be in a state of happiness within. So only when imaginations are sure of ensuring harmony and therefore happiness within. Now we are trying to explore into this natural acceptance, right? And what we are proposing is that if you look into your natural acceptance, right, then you can find out whether you have natural acceptance for relationship or for opposition. What is it? Do you have natural acceptance for relationship or for opposition? Relationship, right? So you have natural acceptance for mutual fulfillment, for complementarity and not for opposition. Similarly, you can see that you have natural acceptance for harmony, right, for mutual enrichment and not for exploitation, right? Similarly, you can see that you have natural acceptance for existence, for coexistence, right, and not for conflict. So basically our natural acceptance is for relationship, for harmony and for coexistence. So only when our desire, thought and expectations are aligned with relationship, with harmony, with coexistence, that we are in harmony within, and therefore we are in a state of happiness within. In fact, as we go on, right, we'll explore into this harmony in family, harmony in nature, harmony in existence, and there we can see and understand the relationship, the harmony in nature, the coexistence in existence, right? And then we can see that our natural acceptance is for these three: the relationship with human being, with rest of nature, for harmony in the nature, for coexistence in existence, right? So after working out the details, we'll get back, you know, and see that this V2, if it is guided by the natural acceptance, by this, right, then we are in harmony within. And if it is guided by natural acceptance, it means it is guided by these three things, right? The coexistence, the harmony in nature, the participation in the larger order or relationship. So when our imagination, when our desire, thought and expectations are guided by these three, the coexistence, the harmony, the relationship, right, then we are in harmony within. So this red arrow is very important, right? This we'll get back, you know, when we talk about the harmony in family, in nature, in existence. There we'll be able to see this coexistence, you know, as existence as coexistence, the nature being in harmony, and there being relationship, you know, with human being and with rest of nature. Right? So when we are able to understand the existence, we'll be able to see the coexistence. When we are able to understand the nature, we'll be able to understand the harmony. And when we contemplate, right, we have the contemplation of our participation in the larger order, in the entire nature, right, we'll be able to see the relationship. So when we have clarity of all this, right, and we can see that this is what is naturally acceptable to us, then this will become the guide to our desire, thought and expectation. If that happens, then we are in harmony within. Therefore, we are in a state of happiness within, right? We will also see that if this harmony takes place, right, if this realization, understanding and contemplation takes place, and if it guides the desire, thought and expectation, we will be in harmony within. And if we are working with this harmony, then the outcome of this would look something like this. So with this guidance of our right understanding based through self-verification on the basis of natural acceptance, right, if our desire, thought and expectations are guided by this, then our behavior with human being will lead to mutual happiness, our work with rest of nature will lead to mutual prosperity, and our participation in the larger order will lead to fulfillment of human goal, which ultimately will lead to undivided society and universal human order, right? So this undivided human society and universal human order can be ensured on the basis of understanding of the harmony in existence as coexistence, in nature as harmony, and in, you know, our relationship with other human being and with rest of nature. But that we will see as we go on, right? I have just mentioned this to give you a feel, you know, that ultimately this is how our, you know, imagination would look like, this is how our conduct would look like, and that would be the final result of it. Good. So for the time being, what we are saying is very simple, that as long as our imagination, right, the desire, thought and expectation is falling in line with our natural acceptance, that is, it is in harmony within, right, we will be in a state of harmony within, and therefore we will be in a state of happiness within. If it is otherwise, that is, if it is guided by preconditioning or sensation, we are not sure, right. So, to ensure harmony in the self, what we need to ensure is that all our imaginations are in line with our natural acceptance, right, and not otherwise. That would be the meaning of harmony within. So, for the time being, this is what we can, you know, say, as we go on, as I said, we can see the details of what is it that is naturally acceptable, you know, the coexistence, the harmony, the relationship. And then we can say that only if our imagination, the desire, thought and expectation fall in line with the coexistence, that will be in harmony within, and therefore will be in a state of happiness within. As if the condition today, right, if you look at what is happening today, and when we are asking what, you know, percentage of desire is coming through preconditioning, what percentage is coming through sensation, what percentage of it is coming through natural acceptance, right, we found that the majority of them are coming either from preconditioning or from sensation, very few from natural acceptance. So if you look at that percentage, it looks like this. The major part is coming from preconditioning. Then next major part is coming from sensation. Very little is coming from natural acceptance. So that is the area of happiness for you. But if we develop this, you know, right understanding through self verification, through self exploration, right, then this can be expanded, right, and ultimately made 100%. That will be the state of continuous happiness. So this is a brief, you know, kind of proposal about harmony in human being, harmony in the self, right. Now you can go on verifying this, and as I said, at this point what we can see is that as long as our desire, thought and expectations are in line with our natural accept, right, for other things like preconditioning and sensation we cannot be sure, right, but the exact detail of what is naturally acceptable to us, you know, is what we will explore as we talk about harmony in family, you know, harmony in nature, harmony in existence and so on. So good, with this what I would like to do is to sum up our discussion, right, on harmony in this self. So if you look at the sum up, so let me read it out. The self I has activity of desire, thought and expectation together called imagination. This is going on continuously, but for you have to verify, right, this is a proposal from my side. The behavior work is an expression, an outcome of imagination. Imagination is motivated by preconditioning, sensation or natural acceptance, this we have already seen. Desire based on natural acceptance leads to harmonious thought and expectation. This is harmony, this is, right. So if the desires are based on natural acceptance, then we are in a state of harmony within. This is the state of Svatantrita, this is the state of happiness, right. In that state, the behavior and work is also mutually fulfilling, right, and we have a definite conduct. On the other hand, if the desires are based on preconditioning or sensation, right, it may lead to contradiction in thought and expectation, right. So if our desire, thought, desires are coming from imagination, from preconditioning or from sensation, we cannot be very sure, right. Number one, it will be in, you know, contradiction with the, it may be in contradiction with the natural acceptance, therefore it will lead to unhappiness. This contradictory desire may also lead to contradictory thoughts and expectation, so that will also lead to unhappiness. So we are saying that this would be the state of disharmony in the self if the desires are not based on natural acceptance. This is the state of disharmony, this is the state of pratantrita, this is the state of unhappiness. In this state, the behavior or work may or may not be mutually fulfilling. Therefore, the conduct is not definite. So therefore, we are saying as long as the desires are coming from natural acceptance, we can be in harmony within. If they are coming from preconditioning or sensation, we cannot be sure. It may lead to harmony, it may lead to disharmony. it may lead to contradiction. Therefore, it may lead to happiness or unhappiness. So, the harmony in the self is ensured only when our desires, thought and expectations are in line with our natural acceptance. So, that is the state of harmony in the self. So, this with this as the background, there are some homework for you which you have to start working on, and after stating about the homework we will get back to the question, right, if there are any. So, let us come to this homework. So, number one is, are activities of desire, thought and expectation going on in you? This you have to find out, right. So, find out or go on finding it out. Second is, are these going on continuously or you can stop them? Can you stop the activity of desire, thought, expectation, or they are going on continuously? Third, this is very important, make a list of your imaginations, right. So, make a list of your desire, thought and expectation, then categorize them, right, into these three categories, right. Those that are about physical facility and sensation, right. Then desires which are related to feeling in relationship or lack of it, and understanding or lack of it. So, three possibilities, right. Your desire may be related to physical facility, or it may be related to the feeling in relationship, or it may be related to understanding in the self. So, sort them out. Then, now that you have made the first list, then you can divide these desires as those that are connected to the need of the self and the need of the body. So, this is the part 2 of the third observation. Then part 3 of the third observation is, right, you categorize these desires, okay, as those that are motivated by preconditioning, those motivated by sensation, those motivated by natural acceptance. So, do this homework. Next time when we meet, we'll, you know, see if there are questions on this. But if you have any immediate question on what we have discussed on harmony in self, we would certainly like to take it up.